Now, baby, yeah, I'm as free as a bird. I'm as free as a bird. Well, I've been flying through the trees, and I've been dancing on the breeze. I kiss the sun now every morning. I've been shaking off the chains. I've been giving up the games. I've been answering my calling. And as soon as I surrendered, the light began to end. Last night I had a dream that I could find.
Hello everybody, hi and welcome to this webinar on staying calm in times of overwhelm, which is part of International Coaching Week. And it's very exciting. International Coaching Week is a week-long global celebration on the power and impact of professional coaching. So an amazing week, and it is really truly an honor to be part of it. And feel free, all of you, to turn on your camera. I see already some faces. I see beautiful Maribel. I see beautiful Jackie as faculty here as well. And hi, Hannah, I see you coming on screen as well. Anna, everybody, feel free to turn on your camera. And before we dive into today's webinar, I would love our faculty to say a quick hi before we start. So Jackie, maybe you first and then Maribel.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Anna-Karine. I'm so happy to be here with you all today. And I'm looking forward to what I know will be a really wonderful session. And I, you know, for those of you that have had the privilege of being part of a cohort with Anna-Karine, you will know that she has the most wonderful, warm manner, and just makes you feel so comfortable in whatever space that you're in with her. But I also love the way that she's able to give so much clarity around, you know, so many things that are on our mind. So I'm really excited to be here, and been really enjoying, you know, what's available to all our faculty and students and wider community for International Coaching Week. So look forward to connecting with you all soon. And I will pass you over to the wonderful Maribel.
Hi, thank you, Jackie. Hi, everyone. I'm so glad to be here as well. I'm so excited to learn together with you from our dear Anna-Karine and her team over here in New Zealand. So yeah, enjoy. And I'm just going to be here to learn with you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, both Jackie and Maribel. And For those of you who don't know me, I see some familiar faces, but I also see some unfamiliar faces. So for those of you who don't know me, and my name is Anne-Karine Vandeveld. So I am an ICF professional certified coach, and I'm one of Coach Masters Academy's facilitators, and I'm the director of training for Coach Masters Academy for New Zealand and Australia. And I'm your host and your presenter for today. And again, I'm super excited to be here with you and to share this virtual space with you and to dive into this topic on staying calm in times of overwhelm. Because it sure is a time of overwhelm, isn't it? Who is experiencing overwhelm at the moment? I'm wondering, any show of hands? Anybody experiencing? Yes, yes. Me too. I think all of us, right? Thank you for being so honest there. Yeah. So I think we're all experiencing some form of overwhelm. If anybody wants, feel free to share an area in the chat where you are experiencing overwhelm at the moment. Is there a specific area where you are experiencing overwhelm? So for me personally, it's really in the digital area, especially emails are quite overwhelming for me at the moment. But there's so many areas that can be overwhelming for anybody. So feel free to make this a little bit interactive and share in the chat. Balancing work and family life. Yeah, I think a very common one, right? I think for many of us, that's a big one too. Thank you so much for sharing that. Yeah, as I said, I think we all experience some form of overwhelm, and it's really hard not to, with all the things happening in the world, with all the change globally, socially, personally. Like I said, with all our inboxes exploding, I'm sure I'm not the only one. With all the demands that are coming at us from all sides, so whether that's work, whether it's training, or whether it's family, there seem to be more things to do and less time to do it. So whoever we talk to, we all seem to experience overwhelm. It is in the air. And I know I'm getting us all into a loss frame at the moment, into a negative mindset, but don't be alarmed, because we're going to transform that into a gain frame shortly. So into a positive mindset, or at least that is my intention for all of you, to walk out of this webinar feeling empowered with the tools to create calmness in our lives, whatever happens outside of you. Is everybody ready for that? Wonderful. Okay, let's get started. So I like to think of creating calmness as looking after our skin. Because when we think of creating a healthy skin, we know we need to do both things on the inside and on the outside. So we know we have to drink lots of water. We know we have to eat healthy to support that healthy skin. We know we have to sleep. We have to limit stress. You know, there's so many things we can do on the inside. But then also, we know that there are things we can do on the outside, like wearing sunscreen, wearing hats, protect the skin from harsh colds and apply creams, etc. So there are many things we can do both on the inside and on the outside. And the same goes for creating calmness. There are things we can do on the inside and on the outside. So to bring in a metaphor, as we are in the coaching environment, so when we are experiencing a storm, so when we are on the open sea with our little boat, of course we want to be able to stay as calm as possible on the inside, to navigate through the storm as best as we can. We don't want to panic, you know, we want to stay calm. But also, we want to do things to try to sail our boat to calmer waters. So we want to do what we can to get to those calmer waters too. So in this webinar, we will touch on both. It is my intention for you to walk away with inside and outside tools that will help you create that calmness that we're all after. And some of these tools, they may be new to you. And some, or maybe many, may not be new to you. But even if they're not new to you, I really hope that hearing them again will be a great reminder for you. And I hope that they will inspire you to do something with them or breathe new life into them. So have your pen and your paper ready to take some notes, because we're going to dive into it. And let's start with some inside tools. So inside things we can do to create calmness in times of overwhelm. So tools to stay calm and centered, because that is what what we want, isn't it? To be calm and centered and handling any challenge with elegance and grace. And I think we all encounter these magnificent people sometimes, you know, who radiate elegance and peace and calmness, no matter what is happening around them, which is such a different experience than coming from a place of stress, which in reality, most of us experience and act upon most of the time. So we want to have as many tools as we can to reduce stress, or at least to move out of stress and move back to feeling calm and centered instead. But before I move on to these tools, I know I said we were going to move on to the tools, but before we do, I would like to take a moment to touch on the topic of stress, which is the opposite of calm, of the calmness that we want to create. And stress is a really little word, but it tends to have a big impact on our lives. And I want to give you a little background on it, because if we understand why reducing stress is important, then the how will become easier, because we can assign more meaning to what we are doing. And to start off really basic, I want to touch on something that I learned from the great master Eckhart Tolle. And that is that stress is not the external factor in our lives. And this was actually discovered by the Canadian researcher Hans Selye already 7 decades ago. And let me share the slides here. So stress is not the external factor in our lives, but instead it is our perception and reaction to them. So stress is our perception and reaction to the situation. So, for example, if we arrive at the airport and we see that we missed our flight, we will probably experience stress. Who would experience stress when they miss their flight? Who would experience stress? But it is not the situation. It is not the fact that we missed our flight that creates the stress. But it is our perception and our reaction, our emotion about it. It is us reacting to the situation that creates the stress. You know, our thoughts like, oh, this is so bad. This is costing me so much money. I can't afford a replacement ticket. Or my friends who are already there, they will be so upset and angry with me. It is our thoughts and it's our perception and it is our reaction that causes the stress. Because another person could miss the same flight and think, you know what? I didn't want to go to Paris anyway. I'm simply going home and I'm going to have some time for myself. This is great. I actually met a person one day who was thinking like that. So same situation, and one person is stressed and the other person is happy. And I'm not saying here that we should perceive every situation as positive. That's not what I'm saying. But I am saying here that stress is not created by the situation. It is our perception and our reaction that creates stress. So we have the perception that missing our flight is bad, and so we feel stress. It is our emotional response to the situation. And the emotional response, it may be in the form of overwhelm, it may be in the form of worry, maybe anxiety, maybe fear, however it shows up for us. And there can be physical symptoms as well. For example, a racing heartbeat, or maybe muscle tension in the jaw. This is where I often feel tension. Or in the belly, I feel that one too. Or maybe the chest. This is really personal, but oftentimes there are physical symptoms as well. But so again, it is not the situation, but our perception and reaction that causes stress. Very basic, but very important. And then one of the other things that I learned is how quickly we experience stress. You know, we always think of stress and going into fight or flight mode when big things happen to us. But actually, it turns out that we turn on our fight or flight system simply when we are feeling negative emotions. So when we are feeling negative emotions, we experience stress. Stress is emotional unease. And the experience, it ranges really from low-grade feelings of emotional unrest to intense inner turmoil. And this is really something that I had to learn. There is a spectrum of fight or flight. So we don't need to be super stressed to be in fight or flight. And to give you some examples, so you already turn on the fight or flight nervous system. For example, when you feel frustration with, for example, a colleague or maybe your partner, or frustrated or maybe even angry with that person who drives dangerously. Or maybe you feel jealousy with a colleague who made promotion. Or for us coaches, you know, maybe not feeling intelligent or maybe not feeling good enough or maybe insecure after we struggle during a coaching conversation. So when we are feeling a negative emotion, our brain is releasing stress hormones. So stress, it shows up a lot in our lives. Most of us spend 70% of our day, so 70% of our day in stress response, in fight or flight, because it's so easy to do. We don't need an actual tiger. A negative thought and emotion is sufficient to turn on our fight or flight response, conscious or unconscious. So as, let me share here again. So as life coach Tony Robbins said, most people have a highway to stress and a dirt road to happiness. So most of us experience stress most of the time, chronic stress. That is the reality, and especially in times of overwhelm. And one of the other important things I learned from another teacher, Dr. Joe Dispenza, who is into neuroscience, is that it is actually okay to react with stress. We all get triggered into stress, but we don't want to stay in stress. We don't want to continue to stay in stress. We want to ask ourselves the question we see here on the slide, the question that Dr. Joe Dispenza taught me: how long are you going to react? We want to snap out of it as soon as we can. So when we arrive at the airport and we see that we missed our flight, it is okay to react. It is okay to feel stressed. But then we want to become calm again as soon as possible. So we want to shorten that time we are in stress. We want to shorten the refractory period of our emotional response or in our emotional reactions, as Dr. Joe Dispenza calls it. And the same goes for when the storm hits our metaphoric little boat. You know, in whatever form the storm has taken on in our life, it is okay to stress out. But then we want to turn back to calmness as soon as possible. So we don't have to be people who don't get stressed and don't get overwhelmed at all. But we do want to experience stress and overwhelm only for short amounts of time and then become calm again. So one of the main things we want to master is to transform stress, whether the stress is overwhelm, whether it's anxiety, whether it's worry, whatever form it shows up for us, and whether it's massive or whether it's small, we want to transform that stress into calmness as soon as possible. And if we know that stress is not caused by the situation, but by our perception and emotional response, then we want to increase our ability to better regulate our emotions. Does that make sense to everybody? Making sense? Wonderful. Wonderful. So we want to be able to shift out of our emotional state. That is an important step for reducing stress in our lives and inviting in calmness. Because again, it's not the situation that causes the stress, but it's our perception and our reaction to it. So let's move on to our first tool. And I would like to offer you a tool that I learned from the HeartMath Institute in California. The HeartMath Institute, they conduct research into the physiology of emotions, our brain interactions, and much more. And they have found a simple solution to reduce stress and invite in a replacement feeling, such as calmness. And I would love to introduce this tool to you. And it is really simple and it really works. And the tool is called attitude rating. Quickly show that on the slide. So let's practice this tool together. And what I would love you to do, I would love you to think about a common stressful event that causes stress for you. So whether that is in the form of overwhelm or anxiety or worry or frustration, but something that triggers stress for you. So I would love to invite you to take a moment to think about a common event or a common situation, or maybe a person, or maybe a thing that causes stress. So if you can all take that moment and think about that, and if you feel comfortable, feel free to share in the chat as well. Did everybody identify something? Wonderful. So then I would love you to think about the stressful feelings that you experience as a result of that. So maybe that's worry, maybe it's overwhelm, like the title of this webinar, maybe it's frustration, maybe it's an anxiety, maybe it's a combination of many feelings, maybe it's something else. So please feel free to take a moment to think about it. Did everybody identify? Yes, wonderful. Now remember, the stressful feeling is actually causing you the stress, not the situation. So we're going to work with that stressful feeling you just identified and transform it into something else, something good, like calmness, for example. And the scientific technique that can help us do this, as designed by HeartMath Institute, is called the attitude breathing technique. And this technique, it puts our heart and our brain in sync. And it enables us to replace emotions, so negative and stressful emotions, into good ones. So that is wonderful. So off the list of stressful feelings you experience, can you pick one stressful emotion you often feel? So it might be overwhelm, it might be worry, any emotion that is stressful. Everybody has identified one emotion you want to work with. Beautiful, fantastic. Then next, I would love you to think to pick a replacement emotion you would rather feel. So take a moment to think about that. And that can be, for example, maybe calmness, maybe feeling peaceful, maybe feeling loving, maybe gratitude, maybe compassion, or maybe ease or flow. So what replacement emotion would you rather feel? And just pick one. Did everybody pick one? Wonderful, fantastic. So we have a stressful emotion we often experience, and we have a replacement emotion we would rather feel instead. So we have two identified. Now I would love you, if you're in a place where you can do so, I would love to invite you to close your eyes for a moment and focus the attention in the area of your heart, and that is the center of your chest. So when we focus on our heart space, we send a signal to our body and it says something just changed, because normally our awareness is outwards. So when we focus on our heart space, we turn our attention inward. And we can even place our hands on our chest, as our attention will always go into the area of touch. Now the second part is to slow down our breath. So begin breathing slower than usual and deeper than usual. So take a deep breath into the nose, rising the belly for about 5 seconds. And out. Breathing deeply. And continue to breathe slowly and deeply. And start to breathe as if the breath is coming from your heart space, so the area of your chest. So imagining the breath is flowing in and out of the chest area, while breathing slower and deeper than usual. And this is called heart-focused breathing. So placing our attention in the center of our chest, and imagining the breath is flowing in and out of the chest area, are breathing deeper and slower than usual. And find an easy rhythm that is comfortable for you. And now that we're in our heart space and breathing slowly, we can start replacing our emotion. So breathe in your replacement emotion. So maybe for you that was ease. Maybe it was calmness. Maybe it was flow or love. Maybe gratitude. Maybe peace. Breathe in your replacement emotion. Breathing in, breathing out, breathing and feeling your replacement emotion. And continue until you feel a shift in your emotions. Let's take one more deep breath. And let's come back to the room. And observe how you're feeling right now. So have you reduced the intensity of the feeling you were replacing? So the situation may not have changed, but hopefully your relationship with this is shifting. How was that? Feeling good? Wonderful. So to recap, I will share this slide with you, what we just did. So to recap, so you pick your stressful emotion and your positive replacement emotion. So be really clear on those. Then you focus on your heart space. And you breathe slowly and deeply from your heart space. And then finally, you create a replacement emotion by breathing and feeling into this emotion until you feel a shift in your emotion. So that was attitude breathing. And it's a beautiful tool that we can use to transform overwhelm or any other stressful feeling into calmness or any other positive replacement emotion that we choose. And even a simplified version of that is really helpful. One that we often use as facilitators at CMA before we start a learning session, for example. I even just did it just before this webinar. But it's to identify what we want to let go of in our out-breath and what we want to breathe into. So, for example, on every exhale, we let go of nerves. And then on every inhale, we breathe into warmth or clarity or inspiration or being encouraging or being confident, whatever we pick. So we often take a few minutes to do this before a session with our faculty, and even this simplified version tends to be very powerful. Now the second tool I would like to offer is mindfulness. So mindfulness has been shown to significantly reduce stress and to create calmness. Mindful people, they can cope better with difficult thoughts and emotions without becoming overwhelmed or shutting down emotionally. So pausing and observing the mind, it helps us resist getting drawn into wallowing into a setback, you know, the famous spiraling down. So put another way, mindfulness weakens the chain of associations that keep people obsessing about their problems and their failures. So they don't get caught in the loop, that spiral. I think we all know, we have all experienced that. So mindfulness is a tool to calm down and to get centered. So what is mindfulness? The term mindfulness is used a lot, and there are many definitions out there for this term. I would like to stick to the definition of John Kabat-Zinn. He is a professor of medicine emeritus at the University of Massachusetts Medical School, and he's the author and the founder of the mindfulness-based stress reduction program. And Jon Kabat-Zinn defines mindfulness as presence of the heart, the awareness that arises by paying attention on purpose in the present moment and non-judgmentally. So to me, it feels like paying attention from here. And I know this sounds great, but how do we do it? How can we practice mindfulness on a day-to-day basis in a simple way? How do we become mindful? Well, being mindful, it first of all requires us to become aware. So aware of our physical sensations, aware of what we're thinking, aware of what we are feeling. And this means that we have to become really present. So when we are thinking about the past or when we're worrying about the future, we are not present. And a great deal of what people say, think, or do is actually motivated by fear, which is, of course, always linked with having our focus on the future and being out of touch with the now. So being mindful, it really means being here and now. So the first step to being mindful is to become present, to be here and now. And an easy way to ground ourselves in the present moment is to become aware of our breath, to notice our breathing. This is one of the most common and probably most simple and effective techniques to become present. And I would love to invite you to join me in a little breathing mindfulness exercise to show you how easy it is to become mindful. Everybody up for another little exercise? Wonderful, fantastic. So if you could sit up straight, and if you feel comfortable to do so, please close your eyes and take a deep breath in through the nose. Breathing in and notice how the air flows into your nose. And feel your belly and your chest rise as they fill up with air. And then flow out of your nose or mouth. And feel your belly and your chest go flat. And again, breathing in. And notice how the air flows into your nose. And feel your belly and your chest rise and hold the breath for a moment. And release and feel how the air flows out of your nose or mouth. And just continue to breathe naturally. And continue to pay attention to your breath. Become aware as you're breathing and focus on your breath, keeping your eyes closed. And this will ground you in the present moment. And now that you're in the present moment, let's move on to the second step of being mindful. Keeping your eyes closed, and that is becoming aware. So become aware now of your body. So what sensations are you feeling? Are you tensed up maybe? Maybe in your jaw, your face, your belly, your chest, shoulders? What sensations are you feeling in your body? Take a moment to notice. And what emotions do you feel? Maybe unease, maybe frustration, maybe some anxiety, or maybe you feel happy, maybe joyful. What do you feel? Take a moment to notice what emotions you feel. And what are you thinking? What thoughts go through your mind? And don't resist them, but just notice them. Because an essential component of mindfulness is acceptance. So whatever you're thinking and feeling in this moment is neither right or wrong. We don't label our thoughts, our feelings, or experiences as good or bad, and we try not to change or resist them in any way. We notice them and we accept them. And then we move on to the next moment without getting caught up in judging what we're feeling or thinking. So just notice your thoughts. And let's take one more deep breath into the nose. And breathe out. And let everything go. And when you're ready, come back to the room. Everybody feeling okay? Feeling good? Wonderful. Yeah, so this was a little breathing mindfulness exercise. It only took 2 to 3 minutes. I put a meditation in the chat. If this is something that is working for you, feel free to, and you would like some guidance, feel free to start using that. Let me recap what we just did. So a recap of the steps to become mindful, and we just went through them. So first of all, we become present. So just simply be here and now. And an easy way to ground ourselves in the present moment is to become aware of our breath, to notice our breathing. Then become aware of our body. So what sensations are we feeling? Our emotions, what do we feel? And our thoughts, so what are we thinking? And we do not label our thoughts and feelings or experiences as good or bad, and we try not to resist them in any way. We simply notice them, we accept them, and then we move on to the next moment without getting caught up in judging what we are experiencing, thinking, or feeling. And before I move on, I would like to expand a little on this accepting component of mindfulness. We just saw it under bullet 3 of the slide. I would like to point out here that this accepting component in mindfulness is not about accepting our fate, you know, like getting a diagnosis of a terminal illness and just accepting that we're going to die. Not that that we should ever do that, but you get what I mean. Nor is it about accepting poor treatment from other people, but it is about accepting our internal experience, our thoughts and our feelings, which informs us about how to respond to our external circumstances in a wiser way, instead of reacting in our usual automatic way, so in our default way. So acceptance also doesn't mean we like it. It doesn't mean that we like what we are aware of. Our thoughts and our feelings are not always likable. And some people find this hard. They find it hard to accept their unpleasant feelings and thoughts. So what works for a lot of people is to name their feelings or thoughts in a calm and a gentle tone. So label them. So for example, I am feeling sad, and that is okay. So naming our feelings can promote acceptance. And acceptance also, it doesn't imply inaction. So acceptance just takes away the resistance. The acceptance applies to the present moment. This is what it is. And then we decide what to do, what action to take from that place of presence, that place of awareness and acceptance. So if our mind is controlled by fear, so if we are in a fight or flight state, then it's difficult to take wise action. Because in that fight or flight state, we may send that email that we later on regret, or we may lash out to someone and then later on we wish we hadn't. But if we're mindful, however, and we accept our anger, so if we feel angry and we accept our anger in the moment, then it may prevent us from lashing out to that person and help us see that our feelings aren't their fault. So in a nutshell, being mindful, it is becoming present. So notice our breath to become present, and then from that place of presence, become aware of our body, our sensations, our feelings, and our thoughts. And then accept whatever is for what it is, whether we like it or not, and then take action from that place. So that is mindfulness, and it is a tool to calm down and to center ourselves. But being mindful, so being really aware and paying attention on purpose in the present moment and coming from a kind place without judgment, it is hard because our minds are not used to this. According to a Harvard study, our mind wanders 47% of the time. So that is a lot. Our minds are used to wander 47% of the time and to run an unconscious program. So when we walk from our desk to a meeting room, for example, trying to be mindful and holding on to awareness with kindness and with self-compassion, it is hard because before we know it, we will probably notice many thoughts that, you know, are popping into our head. And we will probably hear that little voice attaching all kinds of judgments to our thoughts, or maybe some ego thing grabs us and likes and dislikes come up, or wanting or not wanting, or we may get bored and we check our phone. Our minds, they tend to wander and run an unconscious program. And being mindful, It is like watching a show on television and then hitting the pause button. We don't like to pause the show. We want to run it all the way through. So mindfulness is hard, but it is a skill that can be learned. And we will become better at it the more we practice. It is like going to the gym. And I know we use this analogy a lot in our coaching training, and it applies to mindfulness as well. You know, when we go to the gym, we may not see instant results, but when we hang in there, we build our muscles, in this case, our mindfulness muscles. And I know that you probably don't get excited by the idea of learning a new skill on top of all the other duties and things you have to do already. I don't want to overwhelm you here. So in order for us to build our mindfulness muscles and in order to make this practical, I would like to offer you some easy mindfulness practices that we can implement into our day, because that is my intention, to give you tools that you could weave into your day. And I also would like to remind you that you don't need to be mindful all day long. In fact, I can't imagine anybody being mindful all day long. Even the most mindful monk will have moments where the mind wanders, I'm sure. But we can implement mindful moments into our day. And the more we do it, the better skilled we will become and the easier it will become. So here are some suggestions for tools and practices to weave mindfulness into our day. So here we go. First of all, the pause and gratitude before work. So in the morning, so when we sit down behind our computer, so instead of jumping right into work or right into checking our emails, I would like to suggest to start with 1 minute of pause and do, for example, the little breathing mindfulness exercise we practiced before. So instead of focusing on work or our phone or our emails right away, so just to take a moment to breathe and to notice our breath and to ground ourselves in the present moment. And then become aware of our body. So what sensations are we feeling? How is our jaw? How are our shoulders, our chest, our belly? Is there any tension? And what emotions do we feel? Are we rushed? Are we maybe feeling a little bit anxious, maybe afraid, maybe good feelings, like maybe calm, maybe relaxed. So what do we feel? And then our thoughts. So what are we thinking? What thoughts go through our mind? And again, don't resist them, but we just notice them. And once we are at this stage, we are mindful. And we could even take 1 more minute to raise our energy to a higher level, to a coherence level, and start our day from that higher level of energy. Now, how do we do that? How do we raise our energy? Well, we can think of an emotion we would like to feel. So like we did with the attitude breathing. Or simply by, for example, appreciating 3 things we have. So gratitude is one of the most powerful ways to raise our energy. And this can be for really simple things like sitting on a comfortable chair or a cup of coffee or the clothes that we are wearing or maybe the smile of our child in the morning or a colleague or maybe the coffee guy or the coffee woman. You know, just take a moment to appreciate 3 things that we are grateful for, whatever it is, and then start our day. And by doing this, we will start our day from a higher energy level, and then things tend to flow more easily. So to recap, uh, So start our day with 1 minute of pause and gratitude by doing the little breathing mindfulness exercise. So take a moment to breathe deeply to calm our body down. So this tells our body that we are safe. And then notice our breath to ground ourselves in the present moment. And then we can expand our mindfulness by becoming aware of the sensations in our body, becoming aware of our emotions, and becoming aware of our thoughts. And then we can raise our energy by consciously appreciating three things we are grateful for. So again, if this is something that you like, I have a meditation you're welcome to use. I will pop it into the chat. There we go. So next, the next tool for mindfulness, a mindfulness tool. We can practice mindfulness during breakfast or lunchtime by having a mindful breakfast or lunch. Now, how do we do this? Well, when we have breakfast or lunch, we can make sure that we don't eat behind our computer, or at least we can power off our computer so we can fully devote our time to breakfast or lunch. And we're not trying to do multiple things at the same time. Also, put our phone away, even if it's just for 5 minutes, And I know this one is probably really difficult for many of us. And then when we eat our lunch or our breakfast, try to eat mindfully. And what I mean by that is try not to think about other things while we eat, but really give our breakfast or our lunch our full attention. So really notice the taste of the food and the drink we put into our mouth and really try to chew well and observe how the food makes us feel and the signals our body sends us about the taste and the satisfaction and fullness. So to recap, when we have breakfast or lunch, power off our computer, put our phone away, and give our breakfast or lunch our full attention. Chew well and really notice the taste of the food and the drink and observe the signals in our body. So eating mindfully is a great way to practice mindfulness during our day. Then next we have, I'm going a little bit fast now, but let's keep moving. Deep breathing and body scan reminders. So as I mentioned, noticing our breath is the most common and probably the most effective way to ground ourselves and to become present and mindful. And on top of that, when we extend our breath and move from normal or maybe even shallow breathing to deep breathing, this sends a signal to our body that all is safe and all is well. Because we only breathe deeply when it is safe. We're not going to breathe deeply when there is a tiger around. So when we breathe deeply, we send a signal to our body that all is safe. There is no tiger. So taking moments during our day to consciously breathe and to breathe deeply is crucial because it makes us both more mindful and it calms us down. And also body scanning is a foundational mindfulness practice. So checking in with our body. So these are fantastic tools that we can use during our day. And the little breathing exercise we did earlier does just that. So noticing our breath, extending our breath, doing a little body scan. But I know that when our day is busy, I know it is hard to remind ourselves to breathe deeply and to do a quick body scan. So I suggest to have mental reminders for deep breathing and for checking in with our body. So for example, every time when we have a tea or a coffee, this is what I personally do. So just simply take a deep breath. This tells our body that we are safe. Notice our breath, which grounds us in the present moment, and check in with our body to expand our mindfulness. So how is our face, our jaw, our shoulders, other parts of the body? Is there any tension? And if there is, then we can take some more deep breaths and breathe into those parts of our body that need to loosen up. And again, we can check in with our emotions. What emotions are we feeling? We can check in with our thoughts. What are we thinking? So let me recap. So every time we have a tea or a coffee or anything else that serves as a reminder, breathe deeply. And this tells our body that we are safe. Notice our breath. And this grounds us in the present moment. And check in with our body and our emotions and our thoughts. And this expands our mindfulness. So these were a few ways of weaving mindfulness into our day, as mindfulness is a tool we can use to stay, to calm down and to stay centered. So that was mindfulness. And now I would like to move on to another insight tool that we can use, and that is meditation. Meditation has a tremendous effect on our nervous system. It calms us down, it centers us, and it makes us emotionally stable. Now you will probably feel like, I don't have time to meditate. Who feels like that? I don't have time to meditate. Anybody feeling like that? I don't get the reaction I was expecting. Maybe you do feel like meditating. But I wanted to point out here, I'm not suggesting that you meditate for an hour a day. And if you do, that's great. But it's not what I'm suggesting here. I am suggesting that you meditate for a few minutes. So incorporate a mini meditation during your day. So even if it is just a 1 minute meditation, weave it in, make it part of your routine. So maybe at the start of your day, at the end of your day. So for example, by practicing pause and gratitude we touched on earlier, maybe whenever you have a tea or a coffee, maybe just before, maybe just after lunch, or maybe when you feel like you need it. So for example, when you've just been knocked out of balance by someone or something, or maybe when you feel overwhelmed by all the emails or by all the demands on your plate, or maybe when you simply, you know, need to lift your energy or boost your confidence. And to show you can even do a 1 minute meditation. I would love to invite you to take that moment with me and do one now. So 1 minute only. Everybody up for that? Wonderful. You guys are wonderful. So sit up straight, and if you can, again, close your eyes. And take a deep breath into the nose, expanding your belly. And as you breathe out through the mouth, release any tension in the jaw. Let it go. And again, breathing in through the nose, expanding the belly. And as you breathe out through the mouth, relax your shoulders. And again, breathing in through the nose and expanding your belly. And on the exhale, release any tension in the chest. And one more deep breath. Breathing in and expanding your belly. And hold the breath for a moment. And on the exhale through the mouth, let all tension go in the body and the mind. Let it all go. And relax. And continue to breathe naturally. And from this place of calmness, I invite you to come back to the room. Did everybody enjoy that? I will put again a meditation into the chat if this is something that you would like to continue doing. That was 1 minute. So I hope that you can see that meditating doesn't necessarily take up a lot of time. It can be really quick. And if these meditations are not for you, please know that there are many ways to meditate. You know, in this webinar, I focused on mindfulness meditation, but there is, for example, also movement meditation. And most people, they will think of yoga when they hear movement meditation, which is a great way of doing movement meditation. But this practice includes much more, such as walking in nature, gardening, or mindfully playing golf, or surfing, for example. So basically, any movement that you do very mindfully and peacefully. So movement meditation, that it's great for people who find peace in action. Then there is, for example, also mantra meditation, which uses a repetitive sound to clear the mind. So that can be a word, it can be a phrase, it can be a sound, such as the popular Om. And some people really enjoy mantra meditation because they find it easier to focus on a word instead of their breath. So this is also a good practice for people who don't like silence and enjoy repetition. But I wanted to point this out here because I believe that there is a meditation practice for everyone, and it's just a matter of finding the perfect practice for you. But at least I hope that it has become clear that meditating doesn't need to take up a lot of time. So let's move on to the next tool. And that is a deep sigh. So another tool to reduce stress and inviting calmness and centeredness is simply a deep sigh. A deep sigh is our body brain's natural way to release tension and to reset our nervous system. So simply breathing in fully and breathing out fully, longer on the exhale. Let's play it out. Let's do one now all together. Let's take a deep breath in through the nose. I have to wait until Janet maybe is done yawning. So sorry, I saw that. Okay, one more time. Let's breathe in deeply through the nose. And let's breathe out. So longer on the exhale. So take your time breathing out. Wonderful. Thank you for playing along. So studies have shown that a deep sigh, it returns our autonomic nervous system from an overactivated sympathetic state, so an overactive fight or flight state, to a more balanced parasympathetic state, so a calm and centered state. So even if what we're coping with becomes more challenging, we can deliberately pair any moment of tension or frustration with a deep sigh to shift our physiology into a more relieved and more relaxed state. And by doing this, we enhance our chances to seeing things clearly and choosing to respond wisely to what is happening. So as coaches, we can even use this during a coaching conversation. So for example, when we feel lost or we don't know what direction to take or what question to ask. So simply take that moment to sigh. So a deep sigh is another tool to reduce stress and to invite in calmness and centeredness. Then another suggestion I would like to make to reduce stress in general and also to stop our emotional response. And that is when we're noticing that we are reacting. And this is not really an inside or an outside tool, but more a doing tool, but an effective tool for sure. And that is exercise. So getting physical. So one of the benefits of exercise is the effect it has on stress. So not only does it pump our body full of feel-good endorphins, but it can also help us sleep better and aid in relaxation. Exercise takes us out of our head and into our body, and it calms us down. So it's definitely a tool we can think about when we think of staying calm in times of overwhelm, or better yet, to get back to calmness in times of overwhelm. And of course, what exercise suits us, that is personal. But one suggestion I would like to make, though, is a nighttime stretching routine, because this is something many people don't think about. Stretching before bed helps us sleep better. It releases endorphins. It's boosting mood and relaxation. It's really, really good for us. So if this is something you are currently not doing and you want to give it a go and you want some guidance, feel free to email me and I'm happy to send you a complimentary stretching video as well. So let's move to the next tool. And that is shifting posture. A really simple tool, yet a really powerful one. So anytime we move our body and shift our posture, we shift our physiology, which in turn shifts the activity of our autonomic nervous system. So we can use movement to shift our emotions and our mood. So for example, if we're feeling scared or we're feeling nervous, research has shown that taking a pose that expresses the opposite of that, like, you know, putting our hands on our hips, our chest out and our head held up high, this will make us feel more confident. Lots of us will also know these as power poses. So if we are experiencing a state of overwhelm, a state of fear, or any other unwanted negative emotion, we can try shifting our posture and let our body move into a posture that expresses the emotional state that we want to develop to counteract what we are feeling. So that is another tool that I wanted to bring in. And then time off. So Sir Gary Cooper, he is a professor of organizational psychology and health of the Manchester Business School of the University of Manchester. He mentioned that we live in a culture where the pressure is always on. He says something like 40% of people wake up and the first thing they do is check their email. And for another 40%, it's the last thing they do at night. And a macho working culture where employees want to be seen to be available on email at all hours, it's causing stress and depression, and in turn makes us less efficient. And we all know this, you know, the boundaries between work and home, they have eroded. You know, the universality of mobile devices means that working outside of conventional hours and beyond the workplace has never been easier, and leading to this always on culture. You know, where in the olden days, you could simply shut the door of the office and leave work behind, you know, imagine that. But now we take work with us in the form of our phone. You know, as long as we have our phone with us, we have our work with us. And the thing is that this always on culture and pressure, it means that there is no time to shut out the noise and fill up our well. Yet it is important to get some time off and fill our well. Time for us, where we are off duty, simply doing what we want to be doing, and simply being you, not the official you, but the real you. And if we take time off to fill our well, we actually perform better at work too. So also in the interest of the quality of our work, it is actually important to take time off and not constantly check our emails and be available for example, our clients all the time. But you may wonder how, you know, I would love to take some time off, but how do I create time off? You know, I met a lady the other day here in Queenstown, where I live. And she mentioned that she was going to do the famous Rootburn hike here close to Queenstown in New Zealand, where there is no internet connection, because she wanted to be disconnected from the internet, and she wanted to have no phone reception, so that she wouldn't be able to receive calls and emails and messages and just have some time for herself. And I think it is funny, because I think we can all relate to this feeling of this lady, you know, this desire for some real quiet time where no one can reach us. But what we forget here is that we have a choice to be available at all times or not, a choice to check our emails, our messages, our Facebook, our LinkedIn, our Instagram, etc., or not. We have a choice. We are the ones in charge, and we are the ones who can also choose to feel good about it. Because many times, you know, we choose not to be available, and then we feel guilty for not being available, which of course, you know, creates stress. So we are the ones in charge of being available or unavailable, and we are also the ones in charge to feel good about it or not. So a solution to get some time off is to look at our routine and see whether we can make a few tweaks here and there. So are you one of the many people who checks their email or their Facebook or their messages, you know, first thing in the morning or before bed at night, or both? So just be honest. And if so, and knowing that it is important to take some time off, some me time, some quiet time, and especially at the start and at the end of our day, could you build in a routine where you leave your phone untouched for the first hour in the morning, and where you shut it off an hour before bed? Maybe not bring your phone into the bedroom at all. And I know this sounds challenging to many of us, but why not try it for a week to only check our phone an hour after waking up and only up to an hour before bed? And in between, it's resting time, time to calm down, shut off, and simply be you. I would love to challenge you to try it out for a week and to notice what effects this has on you. Is anybody up Anybody up for the challenge? Ah, wonderful. Fantastic. So let's move on. Let me share the screen first. Yes, so sleep. Sleep is important when we want to stay calm. And according to the National Sleep Foundation, stress and sleep are closely connected. So when we don't get enough sleep, our bodies go into fight or flight mode, which means that the body releases stress hormones. But then on the other hand, getting enough sleep on a nightly basis can alleviate stress quite effectively. Now, I don't want to get into the science too deeply of this, but keep it practical and look at some things that we can do to get more sleep. Everybody probably would love to get some more sleep, right? So one of the things that is important is to get our bodies into a resting state before we go to bed. Not being on our phone and on screens for the last hour before bed will help with that. But other practical things we can do to calm down and get into a resting state before bed are a regular sleep schedule is helpful to get a good solid sleep. And this means, going to bed and waking up at the same time each day. Then creating a bedtime routine. So train our body and brain to recognize the signals that it's time to sleep by establishing a nighttime routine. And this can include reading a book, for example, or writing in a journal before bed. Also, taking a bath or a nice hot shower will help to quiet down the body and the mind. And this could be part of our bedtime routine as well. And a meditation is helpful, and stretching, and they can be part of our routine also. Then dimming the lights the last hour before bed, this sends a signal to the brain that it's nighttime and our body will slow down and get ready for bed. So no bright lights, but dimming the lights. Another thing we could do is burn incense like lavender oil, which has a calming effect on the body. And cool rooms promote deep sleep. And a difficult one for many of us, cut the caffeine and alcohol intake. So caffeine, it can stay in our body for up to 8 hours. So if we drink coffee or tea late in the day, it may be difficult for us to fall asleep at night. And alcohol, it may make us feel sleepy at first, but it actually disrupts our sleep later in the night. So especially our very important REM sleep. So these are all suggestions, and they may seem like a lot, but you don't need to do them all. But maybe you can try one or more out and see whether they help you and whether you could weave them into your routine. Because once something is a habit, like brushing our teeth or flossing our teeth, it is just something that we do, and it doesn't require much effort in anymore. Then nutrition as a tool to reduce stress and stay calm. So we all know that, it is important to eat healthy, and especially when we are busy. Most of us are mentally and physically challenged, and we need a lot of energy. So we want to make sure to fill up with the right fuel so we can perform at our best. We don't want to, it's like the classic, we don't want to fill up with diesel when our vehicle requires fuel. But we tend to do this when we are working hard and late. It's so easy to get a package of potato chips from the vending machine, for example, when we are at the office, at night, instead of getting ourselves something healthy. And trust me, I've been there many times. But the truth is that bad eating habits, they add physical stress to our bodies. And unfortunately, when we are busy and stressed, we tend to make poor nutritional choices, and that can actually increase our stress levels and cause other problems. But the flip side is also true. Healthy eating habits and good nutrition, they energize our bodies. So that is wonderful. And I think we all know this, but for most of us, there is a gap between knowing and doing. Most of us, we get these moments of inspiration, when we listen to an inspirational podcast, or when we watch a video, or we read an article, or maybe a book, about the benefits of good nutrition, and we get inspired. And that is great, because, momentum, it gets us excited and ready and prepared to make a change. But then most of us think, when I have time, I'm going to dive into nutrition and I'm going to cook really healthy and I'm going to eat really healthy. But the problem is, you know, time doesn't come in abundance for many of us. So the best solution is to weave in healthy nutritional habits into our routine. Make it a habit, make it a routine. So weaving healthy habits into our routine is the only way to sustain that momentum of excitement to create sustainable, healthy change. And I am not a nutritionist, but there are a few things I would like to mention here, which is, again, less coffee. I love coffee myself, but we know that too much caffeine makes us stressed and it affects our deep REM sleep. So we want to be mindful there and limit our intake. Also, again, less alcohol. And finally, you know, drink more water. I know we all know how important this is. And many of you will already drink a lot of water. Personally, I have to remind myself of this. So if you're like me, try to drink, you know, a glass of water every 2 hours or so. And another thing I wanted to mention here is we don't have to become super, you know, super healthy at once, but we can step up. And what I mean by that is, for example, if we're having 4 cups of coffee a day, we can maybe reduce it to 3. If we tend to eat a whole block of chocolate, we can maybe have half a block of chocolate. Or if you're, you know, you have to be Dutch to understand this one, but I love cheese and I eat a lot of cheese. So one of the things that I did, for example, a few months ago is limit my cheese intake during lunchtime. But again, you have to be Dutch to understand that one. But what I want to point out here is, like, we have a choice to step up and make our nutritional intake a little bit better. And then there are things we can do on the outside as well. So I see this as sailing our boat to calmer waters. So there's things we can do to reach the calmer waters. And of course, you know, what brings us to calmer waters, it differs from person to person. But I do feel that, you know, what most of us have in common is digital clutter, especially in the form of emails. I know this is something I brought up myself. It's something I'm dealing with. Can anybody else resonate? Yes, I think this is something, something many of us can resonate with. So what are some practical things we can do here? Let me show you some tips. So I'm going to show you what I'm doing at the moment. Hopefully it's helpful for you too. So become email smart, is how I called it. So if you can deal with an email within 2 minutes, just do it. If it takes longer, then we can defer. So we can, for example, put these emails in an allocated action folder. So the key is to deal with each message before we move on to the next, and rather than letting them pile up unread. So we treat our inbox as a place to process emails and not to store emails. And if we do want to retain emails, then we can just maybe put them in a folder or something. Then unsubscribe aggressively. You know, if you're like me, your name seems to be on every email list and you get a lot of newsletters and emails that you're actually never looking at, except for deleting them. So unsubscribe aggressively and turn off notifications. It has been proven that notifications, they create unrest. So turn them off. And another big one. So instead of dealing with emails the moment they come in, try to deal with email in bulk. So for example, twice a day. And this means that you are in control of your day instead of the email controlling you. I once heard somebody say that email is mostly other people's business. And although this is not always true, but I think if we want to control our day, we have to be the ones that choose when to deal with our emails. Again, I'm dealing with emails at the moment myself, so I want to be smarter with it. And these are some tips that I wanted to share there, and hopefully they're helpful to you for you too. Then another outside tip, and that is declutter your physical space, or at least part of your physical space, because we don't need to have a completely Marie Kondo style decluttered home, but we can have some decluttered spaces. And at least the space where we spend a lot of time. So for example, the space where you are working. This is what I try to do myself. Although I must say it is hard because my office is also my daughter's bedroom, which is why you will always see me with a blurry background. But I at least I try to keep my desk clean and uncluttered. But also, for example, our bedroom, you know, it's a great place to keep uncluttered. You know, when it's time for us to rest, and it's so wonderful to enter a clean and calm space. So a decluttered space, it has an influence on our mental state. So if we can, it's great to have a decluttered home, or at least decluttered spaces within our home. And then finally, last one, I would like you to consider what usually helps you to quiet down your body and mind. So what activities make you feel present and calm and in the moment? For some, this can be, you know, putting on a piece of music. This is something that can help break the negative spiral as well. Maybe it is reading a book, or maybe it's calling a friend, or maybe it's receiving a massage or a facial. Maybe you feel winding yourself down, like some people do when they are playing golf, and they actually become really mindful while playing as they get so involved in the game. But for others, it can be dinner with friends, or maybe, you know, dinner or lunch with family, maybe walking the dog, or maybe going to the theater and getting lost in the story. Or maybe for you, it is tidying up your wardrobe and throwing things out, or maybe it's going to the shops, maybe, you know, buying yourself or picking yourself a beautiful bunch of flowers. So what is it for you? I would love to invite you to take a moment to consider what activities fill up your well. So when do you feel present? When do you feel calm? When do you feel inspired? Do any of the things that are mentioned in the webinar, do they resonate with you? Or are there other things that work for you? And could you do more of those things? So I will just be silent for a minute. And so you can think about it and write them down, because I'm sure once we finish the webinar, you will probably not take that moment. So please feel free to take a moment to think about it. And if you feel like sharing in the chat, then that's great too. Beautiful time in nature, walking my dog every day, being outdoors, hiking. Wonderful. Time in nature is actually one of the other things that has been scientifically proven to calm us down. Tennis, fantastic. Oh, yeah, my dog's attitude is a great reminder to live in the present. Thank you, Hannah. So true. I have my dog underneath the desk at the moment. Oh, cooking. Yeah, I love cooking too, and a great thing to do. Also to practice mindfulness. Yeah, Anna, same. Yeah, wonderful. Thank you, everybody, for taking this moment to think about it. As I said, I'm sure, you know, once we enter webinar, I'm sure nobody is going to take that time. So it's wonderful to do this together. So we are at the end of the webinar, and we discussed many things. And I want to recap before we close. So to reduce stress and calm down and get centered in times of overwhelm, we could try the following tools. So we started out with attitude breathing. Then we moved on to practicing mindfulness, and some mindful practices we discussed were starting our day with a moment of pausing and feeling gratitude, eating mindfully, using deep breathing and body scan reminders. We also touched on meditation, for example, a 1-minute meditation, taking a deep sigh, so simple but very effective, getting physical, so exercise, shifting posture, like also called power poses, and taking time off. And one of the things we touched on is to leave our phone for the first hour in the morning and to shut it off an hour before bed. Getting into a resting state before bed. Good nutrition. Being email smart. Declutter. And anything that is working for you. So walking the dog, or cooking, playing tennis, being outside in nature, whatever it is for you. So if we can implement some of these tools, this will provide you with more calmness and centeredness. So these were the tools that I wanted to share with you. So tools to stay calm and centered, or better yet, to get back to calm, to being calm and centered. Tools to get the best out of yourself so you can shine and be a graceful role model for your clients, your family, your staff, your colleagues, your friends, and your peers. And I really hope that these tools will be useful for you. So like I said, we are at the end of the webinar. Thank you so much for having been here with me. I truly enjoyed sharing the space with you, and I hope you enjoyed yourself too. So thank you. And I hope that you will also enjoy other learning webinars and other live coaching demonstrations during this amazing International Coaching Week. Maribel will be with her team same time like today, tomorrow with the US team. She will be having a webinar on brain wiring, which is amazing. I'm really looking forward to that one. So check out all the amazing things all the amazing opportunities that are there for us. But from New Zealand, and on behalf of all of us at Coach Masters Academy, I'm wishing you all a beautiful rest of your morning, a beautiful afternoon or evening, wherever you are. And we would love to see you soon. I will stay behind if there's any questions. In the meantime, I wanted to play some music, but I see that I somehow did something with my screen that's not working. So I'm just going to say goodbye. But I'm staying behind if there's any questions.